My sermon this morning is entitled, But If Not, and I will say without shame that it is heavily influenced by a sermon by the same title, by a guy you may have heard of before, a preacher that you might have heard of. I don't know, he's a little obscure. His name was Martin Luther King, and I think he was actually a junior. I don't know, not everybody's, I'm kidding. But it's not the same sermon, but it was heavily influenced by it. And so if you hear that sermon, don't think, oh, he's ganking it. No, I'm attributing at the beginning of the sermon. I'm not plagiarizing, but I am bouncing off of his thought a good bit in this sermon, just to let you know that. Last week's sermon was on the Christian gift and virtue of hope. They are both. It is a virtue because we have to exercise it to live in it, but it also is a gift, one of the three that abide, one of them that remains with us. This week, I'm going to be talking about faith. Guess what's coming next week? Anyway, this week, I'm going to be working our way through faith and the impact of faith upon the Christian's life. This is a quote from that sermon that I mentioned a moment ago. It says, if a man has not found that for which he will die, he is not fit to live. I think that is one of the more profound things that that man ever said, and he said an awful lot of profound things. What are you living for? And by that I don't mean how do you make your living, how do you earn your money by which you buy your food in order to survive. I mean, why are you alive? What is it that is so important to you that you'd be willing to die for that thing? You would lay down your life rather than give that thing up. I believe Martin is absolutely correct. If you don't know the answer to that question, you've got to find it. He says that if a person is 38 years old, the way he was when he preached this sermon, and a moment comes, that moment of truth, and they don't know what to do, they don't know whether they're living, they surrender good for the sake of expediency. They might live to be 99, but they will have been just as dead for all the years between 38 and 99 as they were at that moment when they gave up their soul. Who are you, and why are you living? The answer to this question will answer for you. You know, it was put to me really hard when I was, I don't know, 28, 29, something like that, in the mountains of the Dominican Republic. I was there with a group of people from the Fairfax Church of Christ. We were riding on what I could have sworn was a green Hitachi truck, people mover thing with benches in the back. And I was sitting in the back of that thing, bouncing along the unpaved roads of the Dominican Republic with a man who was sort of a member of the Fairfax Church of Christ. He had come along, even though he himself was not entirely sure he was a believer. The guy had lived in Croatia when it looked like that. And he had faced a lot of death. It seems like he'd lost a good bit of his family, although I could be mixing him up some with Luca from ER. He also is from Croatia. But, I mean, it's a year or two ago. Forgive my failing memory. But he had faced horrible things. He'd had guns pointed in his face and at the faces of his family. He had faced crisis. I was still, I mean, I really should have been more a man than I was, but I was still very much a kid in an awful lot of ways. And the subject of martyrdom came up. And I rather flippantly pointed out that, yes, I would absolutely die for Christ. There was no question in my mind. I mean, if it came to it, I would die for Christ. But of course, I could say that because I'd never faced that. And here's this guy who had been at the edge of death more than once, who had lived in the middle of a war zone where the bombs blew up and the bullets flew. And he, for him, this was not theoretical. And what he was telling me is, no, you wouldn't. You would do what it took to survive. And you'd be amazed by how much you would do in order to survive. Who you would betray and what you would give up. The things that you would do, you would betray everyone you love and yourself in order to live. And I remember that it shook me because I knew that shouldn't be right. There should be things that I believe in so deeply that I would be willing to die for them. And I still believe that was true. But how could I know? If I were put into the circumstances where I had to live or die based on what I believe, how do I know what I would do? How do you? How do I sort through my priorities and know this I would let fall away and that I would not? Would I die for my children? Yeah, I think so. I think so. When my son Isaac was bitten in the face by a dog, my first question, I didn't even know I was going to ask it, but when the doctor was talking about having to do plastic surgery, the first question that came out of me was, can you take it from me, please? Please don't hurt him anymore. And I remember going, whoa, I didn't know that was in me. You know, I've been tested on the love for my kids. I'd die for them. Absolutely, I would die for them. Would I die for my Lord? I think so. How do you know? How do you know that your faith is that important to you, that it drives you, that it defines you? Honestly, most of us are never put into circumstances where the question really arises. Not here in America, we're not. Not yet. And as the world rolls on, eventually it comes to everywhere where faith becomes unacceptable. Certain faith postures are not allowed to be. And we've already moved that way some, you know, where you can't have certain businesses and believe certain things. That's already happened in the public sphere. Let it roll on a little further. Who knows? But for most of us during our lifetime, the kind of challenges that says, will you die for this? How do you know? Well, look at the small things. Because it will tell you an awful lot about how you would do when the crisis hits. How are you living your life? What priorities are you setting? What is your faith driving you to do now? What commitment level do you have? What do you give up for other things? Especially look at when it becomes a question of right or wrong, how do you behave? You know, if you're given the moment where you have to surrender your integrity or not, do you do it or do you keep it? And that's a test for you that is like a pop quiz for the main exam that you may or may not ever have to pass. Or when doing what God wants, and you know God wants you to do it, but it will cost you. And there I don't just mean money. You know, because you can always make money, right? It can be very hard to obtain, but most of us aren't willing to surrender ourselves for something so trivial as money. But what about honor? What about a time? What about time with those that you love versus time doing the obedient thing that you know God wants you to do? What do you do? What about engagement in this activity versus that one? How do you prioritize? Because the small things in your life will show you what you would do at the big moment. Really does. And the truth is, right and wrong and doing what God wants, that's not as obvious in any culture as it seems like it is. If you stand outside of a culture and you analyze it from the outside, say you looked at some African tribe. I've done this in graduate school. I did a lot of this, of analyzing other cultures and looking at them from the outside. And you can see their sins very easily. You know what I found is that an African can see America's sins very easily. You know, I had a conversation with an African one time, and I was like, look, polygamy is a real problem. He said, you have polygamy in America. I'm like, no, we don't. He said, yeah, you absolutely do. You just practice it in serial. You marry, divorce, marry, divorce, marry, divorce. We keep all of our exes, and we support them. And you're critical of us? You throw them away. You don't do anything. Like, whoa, ouch. You know, when you stand outside of a culture, you see the pressure that the culture has upon you to be evil. But can I count on it to set me up with right and wrong? With, you know, the laws of government are designed to help me know what's right or wrong. Everything that man ever did was legal. Every single one of his actions, including putting men, women, and children into ovens. It was all legal. Okay, and everything. Do you know who this guy is? Dietrich Bonhoeffer. You know, he participated in an attempt to assassinate that other guy. He was in the Luftwaffe, which was the CIA intelligence agency of the Nazi government. He got himself in there so that he could know things, so that he could give it to the resistance. He died for it. Everything he did was illegal. And yet it was right. You see, good and bad are not relative, and they are not up to us to determine. There is a moral law that exists, and it supersedes every human law. And the laws that human beings write either line up with God's truth and God's reality and God's laws, or they don't. And if they don't, the right thing to do is to resist them. But you do the right thing even if it costs you. You obey God no matter what, because God will never encourage you to be evil. He never wants you to hurt anybody. But He does want you to stand up and say, that's wrong. That is not a thing to be believed. That is not a thing to be done. How do we do it in a world that is hostile in every single human culture? This is not unique to America. Every culture is out of line with God somewhere. How do you stand up and do what's right? Because the truth of the matter is, the will of God often demands that which is very difficult. If your Christian life is easy, there's a good chance you're not doing it right. Okay? God's expectation of self-denial, it runs all the way through who we are to the very center of us. It calls for us to be honorable and good when we want to be dishonest and bad. It calls for us to love people we would prefer to hate. It calls for us to take wounds and give none in return. It is hard. And the will of God calls us to hard things. How do we do it? We do it by faith. But what kind of faith? I told you I was bouncing off of King, and this one is one of his ideas, and I absolutely love it. There's a big difference between if faith and though faith, he says. Or I'll say if faith and even if faith. Okay? If faith basically says, well, if things are sunshine and roses, as long as things are happy and good, I'm going to be a devoted Christian. You see, God has a role in my life, and He ought to know what it is. God's role is to satisfy my wants and wishes and make me satisfied and happy. God's role is to take care of my problems. I'm not expecting to drift through life without any problems. I'm just expecting God to make sure that He takes care of them. So that when I come into problem, as long as God doesn't disappoint me, as long as life keeps cruising along pretty well, I am committed to God. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to be a participant to whatever degree I feel necessary, and I'm going to do what I ought to do. I'm going to be obedient and good as long as God carries His end of the deal. But should a problem arise, if faith says, where are you? If faith will go into crisis pretty easily and pretty quickly, if faith that where God does not live up to His end of things, as if He has a His end of things, as if we as human creatures have any right to expect anything at all of God beyond hell, when God fails, and I've got a picture of a flat tire up here because I had a nice green car in the last slide that came from the B-52's video of Love Shack. You know, but so I threw a flat tire, but sometimes the flat tire is a little more serious than a flat tire, isn't it? Because sometimes the flat tire is the absolute crisis you really hope to avoid and didn't get to. And where is faith then? When the world comes tumbling in, when everything falls apart, or when the pressure is put on you and you're going to lose the client if you are a Christian, or the relationship's going to fall apart If you continue to be who you know God expects you to be, who are you then? Or when you really, really hope she believes it. Because if she doesn't, it's all going to blow up on you. So you're going to lie through your smiling teeth. Where are you? Who are you then? See, because if faith is like, well, you know what? If God really was for me, He wouldn't let me find my way into these kinds of problems. The truth of the matter is that if faith survives very little and it motivates even less. You want to know if you got if faith? What are you doing for God? And that's a good canary in the coal mine to tell you what you got. If you want to know before the crisis hits, look for where in my life have I prioritized Him? Because if you're going to be able to survive the crisis, you need to have prioritized Him. You'll know how to be with Him because of what you did to be with Him. And if you don't know, well, I mean, you live in this world and your sins and the random badness and brokenness of this world is coming. You don't want if faith when it arrives. Especially not when there's something so much better. Before I skip out, have you ever run into that? You know what WWJD stands for, don't you? I know you probably can't read those tiny lines back there. That's like the test at the eye doctor, you know? But underneath it, it says, walruses won't just drive. No, you're right. It says, what would Jesus do? Absolutely. If faith, though, has a different acronym. It's WIIFM. What's in it for me? That's the nature of if faith. It's looking at God and saying, as long as these things fall the way I want them to, I'm going to be in this. I'm going to be a Christian. But let the problem come, and it shakes WIIFM to its core. There is a better alternative, and that's even if not faith. Even if you don't deliver, God, I'm looking at things, and it looks like a storm is brewing. It looks like a problem is coming my way. But even, and I really hope you make that thing dissipate before it gets here. Because I'm not sure I've got the shelter to survive that. But even if you don't, you're still my hope. You're still my God. Or even more powerful than if not is even though. When you stand in the wreckage on the other side, when the thing did blow up, the thing that you were most afraid of comes upon you, and now you have to deal with it, and you have to sort through, how do I love God if this pain is in my life? And even though faith says, even though that happened, I know you're good. And I know that you're able to help me get through this. And even if you don't make it easy, I will continue to follow you. Even though it's here now, and I'm hurting, and I'm sad, that doesn't change who you are. And I will be with you. Even though the wolves are at the door, or they have surrounded me on all sides, and I don't know how I'm going to get out, or if I'm going to get out. Or maybe more appropriate to the biblical text, maybe it's not wolves. Perhaps it's lions. But even though you didn't stop me from being chucked in here with them, I will trust you. I will put my faith in you. I will believe in you and follow you. The prophet Habakkuk is one who wrestled with the justice of God. How is it okay? How is it going to be all right? And he says this stuff at the end of his conversation with God. He says, though the fig tree should not blossom and the fruit not be on the vines and the produce of the olive fail and the fields yield no food. Folks, in an agricultural society, that is absolute crisis. They don't have canned beans. Okay, so if that's the case, you're going to see a lot of starving children. Okay, why would that happen? Because of war, because of deportation, because of exile, which is what God told them is coming. And the prophet says, even if all this happens and there's no livestock anymore, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. That's even though faith. That's the faith that says, I'm going to trust God no matter what comes to me in this broken world, because God is my hope and my song. And I'm going to continue to walk through the hard, even if the hard lasts as long as I do, because I know that God will outlast me and cause me to even outlast myself through resurrection. I will trust Him no matter what. And that's even if I have my hope. And I'm no one to suggest that we should deny our hope. We should hope, because God gives us reason to hope. But I have my hope, but even if my hope is not realized here, I will continue to love and trust my God. And I will continue to do what God wants from me no matter what. Even if I'm not satisfied and I'm not happy, I will continue to do what God expects of me. And right here, right now, I will obey. How? By faith. By faith. I want to get to our text and we'll wrap up there. The book of Daniel is one that Habakkuk prophesied exile. The people who were living through the events of the book of Daniel, they were living in the middle of it. And they had been dragged off, and there was this alien foreign king who wasn't alien and foreign in his land, but he was to the people of Israel, who had pulled them into his land, and now they were reigning over him. He had had this dream of this massive statue, and the prophet Daniel had come to him and explained to him the dream. It was a prophecy from God. The king Nebuchadnezzar had become a prophet of God. So, because he's crazy, he's like, oh, well, I should build that thing. And so that's what he did. You know, and he tells everybody, look, you're going to hear a whole bunch of instruments. When you hear those things go off, you bow down to this thing that I made. That's what he said. But there were three guys, Hananiah, Misha, something, and we only know them by their foreign names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Benny. I'm a closer friendship with Abednego, but... That's Veggie Tales. But those three guys, they heard all of this, and they're like, yeah, no, King, I can't, I won't do that, because I know the moral law. I know the law of my God. I know who my God is. I know what right and wrong are, and allegiance to God is the right thing to do. And worshiping something you made, I mean, God made us. We don't make gods. And so if you made it, that doesn't deserve worship. I'm not going to do it. And so those three men, they refused to bow down. Now the thing is, those three guys have been elevated into government positions. There might have been other Jews in exile who didn't bow down and worship, but those three guys, they were in the firing line. I suspect there were a lot of other Jews who did bow down, because they had even if faith. Those guys, they had even if not faith. And so they stood up when everyone else was on their knees. And if you've ever been standing up while everyone else is like bowing down, you kind of stand out. It's like everybody in the line took one step back and left you standing there. And so they're pretty obvious. And again, because they're government officials in the exiled government, the king takes notice of them. Their faith is on the line. Their lives, in fact, are on the line, because this is what the king says. I mean, he rants and rails for a while, but then he gives them an either or. He says, now, if you're ready when you hear the sound of a whole bunch of instruments to fall down and worship the image that I've made, well and good. We can pretend this never happened. Okay? You just surrender who you are and we'll act like nothing happened. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? It's interesting. It's always a fiery furnace. You know, it's not a watery furnace. You know, but this thing is so hot. It's hot enough that if you try and chuck a human being into it, you're going to die. Okay? The guards that ended up throwing these guys into that furnace died. That's how hot this thing is. So it's a very real threat to their lives. Kinda. A little bit. But they demonstrate that they have even if not faith. Because they say to him, oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this. What? Yeah, you do. He's got the power to kill you. What are you talking about? I'm like, no, I don't have to. I can just stop talking right now, but I'm not gonna, so that you'll be able to rightly interpret my actions. So he says, If this be so, meaning what you just said, if that's right, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. Now, I suspect that they had in mind that, okay, if he burns us up, then God will be there on the other side. If we die, it's going to be all right, because we won't be in his hands anymore. One way or another, we're going to be okay. But I think also they had the idea that, you know what, he can save us. And I suspect what they thought would happen is that somehow God would intervene to prevent the furnace thing from happening. That God would stop it. He'd put the fire out, or maybe Nebuchadnezzar would turn into a beast and run off into the field, because he did that once. You know, so something's going to happen here. It's going to be okay. We're all right. Now that's faith, isn't it? That's amazing faith. But not as amazing as this. But if not. Meaning, even if he doesn't act, if our God lets the worst fall upon us, we will still love him. But if not, if God does not intervene, if God does not save and rescue, if God does not act the way that I hope, but if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. We're not going to do what we know is wrong. We know it's an evil thing, and we know there's pressure being put on us by the world around us, by the rulers around us, by you, O king. You're putting pressure on us to betray our God who has been good to us even in exile. You're putting pressure on us to pretend we are not who we are, but we are going to be who we are. We are people of faith, and we will act based upon our faith, whether God chooses to affirm that or he doesn't. This is a cursed earth, and things don't always work out. We are going to do what's right. We are going to believe and live the way that we know our God wants us to, because we are creatures of faith. And by our faith, God will make us strong enough to do what we must. So, king, do what you want. But we will not do what you want, because what you want is wrong. And we know it. So we won't. Now, this is a few truths from that interaction. And the first that I want you to notice in those guys is that faith gives you courage. Faith is the beginning of courage, because what reason do we have to be courageous if God is not with us? But if God is with us, what reason do we have to be afraid? And so we stand by the truth no matter what. We live rightly and well. And when the world is putting pressure on us to say, don't. We say, I don't care. I'm going to do what is right and good. And remember, that is not an I don't care and I'm going to hurt you. God never encourages us to hurt people. We are to live by love. Love governs everything. But we're going to be good creatures in a broken and evil world. And that takes courage, and we've got it by our faith. Faith leads to knowledge of God's will. How do I know what is the right thing to do? Well, again, everything Hitler did was legal. You're not going to get it from your culture. You get it by revelation. God has given you a reasoning brain, and you ought to think through right and wrong, and you ought to search for how do I be a good person. But ultimately, we are broken and under the curse, and our reasoning capacities are not up to it. We need to be told from the outside. We need God's revelation to show us right and wrong. Faith leads us to listen. Faith prioritizes God and says, you first in my life. And so now I will listen to your direction and do what you want, whether it's popular or not, and especially when it isn't. I'm going to hear the word of God, and by faith I will obey. The Word of God helps me to hear the will of God, and faith helps me to pay attention. Faith gives the ability to do what is right when everyone around you wants you to do what is wrong. There is enormous pressure. And it's not always the threat of death. In fact, it usually isn't. I think if it were more often the threat of death, we might have an easier job with it. And for one thing, you'd have the test once and probably be done. You know, but for another, that it would cause us to be more serious about saying, no, God has said, and therefore I will. The world around us puts subtle pressure, and sometimes it masks as love to disobey. It asks the devil's question, did God really say? That leads to temptation in the first place, and we water down and end up justifying evil and rebellious behavior and call it faith. Genuine faith says, I will listen and obey. I will follow you no matter what pressure, no matter what cost. It's faith that will enable you to do that. You don't have it in you just on your own. You need God with you. And it is faith. The reason faith is able to do this is because it has a friend named hope. It looks beyond what it can see. It looks beyond the moment of right now, and it looks beyond the pain. And it says, there is a God who loves me, and His love is more important to me than hurting. And so I'm going to do what is right even though I hurt. I'm going to trust in my God, and my God has made promises to me, and I believe that He will keep them. So I don't know how here and now. This world is filled with stuff that is troubled and problematic, and I may live my entire life without it ever being affirmed. Jesus, after all, went to the cross. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went into the furnace. But Jesus came out of the ground, and they came out of the furnace because of the act of God. And so I'm going to trust Him that someday, maybe after my life is over and done in this cursed world, God will act. If He must, He will raise me from the dead to reward my faith. And if He does it so often in the here and now, it's worth it. So faith locks its eyes on God and says, come at me, bro. Whatever you bring, world, I will stand against because I have faith and trust in my God who has placed such amazing faith in me. He has honored me to make me His child, and I will walk with Him, and I will not give up who I am, no matter what the perceived reward or escape may be. I will be who I'm supposed to be, even if He doesn't act the way I want Him to. The reality is those three guys went into the furnace, but if you know your Bible, you know the story. That the king looked into that furnace and says, well, how many people we chuck in there? Didn't we throw three guys in there? Because I count four. Because when you stand for God, you may have to stand in flame, but you will not stand alone. And our God has promised that the fire, though it burn you, will not burn you. The water will not sweep you away. You can be strong when everything around you calls on you to be weak, because your God is strong and able to share His strength with you. You can do it. And He saved and delivered them. And when they came out, their garments didn't even smell like smoke. Man, I've been inside fire before. I have. It's a long story. I'll tell you some other time. But I've also stood beside an awful lot of fires. Just standing beside a fire, I've never walked away from that without smelling like smoke. And I've never been in a fire that hot. They were fine. Why were they fine? Because their faith in God. Faith proved itself this day. Folks, it still proves itself to this day. It still does. Because of what it does to us. Because what Nebuchadnezzar meant to be a fire to burn them up turned out to be a kiln to burn away any impurity. And not just them, but all the people who witnessed it that day and everyone who's ever read the story since. It burns away cowardice and it replaces it with faith. That's what this story does. As God grants that we have faith, we live by it. And this is the truth. Whenever we discover that for which we would die, we find that we know how to live. When you know that thing that so inspires you that it says, this is worth dying for, then you live by that. You probably already are. But if it's anything but God, then the thing worth dying for will betray you in the end. God never does. And those who put their faith and their hope in God, who love Him so much that if the time comes and the opportunity is given to you where they say, deny Jesus or we're going to kill you, you say, do your worst. If you have that kind of faith burning inside you, you have a blessed life no matter what. that the sufferings of this world cannot take away, because you already died in baptism and you live now for Christ. So this world is dead to you and you are alive in God. And if that's who you are, you know exactly who you are and why you're for. And that's what faith can do. Faith gives us a reason to live by giving us a reason to die. And when I know what I'm for, I know who I am. This is the gift of God when He gives us faith. If you look into yourself today and you're like, you know, that's really not definitional of me, or I have even if faith, but I want even though. If that's where you are, know that we want to pray for you. It comes from your work with God, but it's far more God's work with you, and you need our prayers if that's where you are, and we want to do it. It may be that you came to this place and you feel like you're in the fire right now, and if that's you, we want to pray for you too. Let us know how we can help and love and serve you. And if you're not a Christian today, today's the day to start. Follow Him in the way of the cross, because it leads to a glory we can't imagine. If this morning you're subject to the invitation of God, there's room right here. Why don't you come while we stand?